I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans white with foam. God bless America, my home sweet home. God bless America, my home sweet home. Tony, can I have the invocation, please?
I borrowed this from the Rotary website, and it's an invocation for the new year. And it goes, new plans, new dreams, new goals, new schemes, new hopes, new fears, new joys, new year. May the new year bring our club new projects, new members, new success, new friends, and a fervor for Rotary that doesn't end. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
One second before we go up and into the new venue for us here, I'd like to take a, with last week's impromptu at George's Cafe, we didn't have a chance to have a formal meeting, but with today, I'd like to get a moment of silence. There's a lot of people here today for our dear friend and true Rotarian, Jim Morris, who has passed away, and there will be a memorial service for him coming up on January 20th at 4 p.m. at Bay Point, and I'll go over that in part of the program too, but a moment of silence for Jim, please. Just for the sake of time and starting a little bit late, I just want to get the program going a little bit. I'd like to thank Christine for handling the money this morning, this afternoon, I mean, and then Rich Morgan, I know you're a little late as our greeter. I don't know if anybody filled in for Rich. And Tony Ward, thank you for that great invocation. And please keep Jim in our thoughts as we have our lunch this afternoon. So thank you for that. Do we have any visiting Rotarians this afternoon? Visiting Rotarians. I have a guest here. I have actually two guests. They're visiting from the Fall River. We have Kevin McNally, and we also have Norm Gauthier from the Fall River Rotary Club. Welcome, guys. Father, you want to...
Eduardo Andres from the Rotary of the... Rotary of the Bridgewater.
Rotary of the Bridgewater. Father Andrea, thank you for this coming this afternoon, Father. Mr. Lindy.
Mark Lindy, Rotary Club of the Bridgewater.
Yes, Mr. Lindy, thank you. Mr. Tennant.
Lieutenant, Rotary Club of Braintree.
And Jessica Club of the
Bridgewater. Welcome, everybody. Welcome. Any more visiting Rotarians? Yes. Yeah. And I know we have some guests in the house today. Miss Elaine Reisner.
My guest is Teresa Ronan, who is a music teacher and also the organist at St. Coleman's. And she has the distinction of having her mother be my first volunteer at the helpline in the first paid state. So
welcome, Teresa. Thank you. I know we have three more guests. Mr. Lutz.
Yes, I have Nicole Frederick.
Ian and Nicole, welcome this afternoon to Brockton Rotary. Thank you. Just for new business, I know Nick's not here today, but we're waiting for some numbers to Nick come in for the basketball tournament. We'll hopefully have that within the next couple of meetings and see how well we did there. We have a makeup breakfast coming up next week on the 19th. That's at Joe's at 7:30 in the morning. So anybody that might not be able to make a meeting during the week at a lunch, you're more than welcome to come to a breakfast at Joe's Diner the 19th at 7:30 a.m. We had a few folks there last week for a different makeup. It was a good time. Encourage you to try to make it if you can. the 18th of January, we have the South Shore Council meeting. That's on a Wednesday. That's something that Jim Morris did all the time for us. He was always there. He did a fantastic job. Hopefully we can get somebody to replace Jim that will continue to go to the South Shore Council. That's at the Hearth and Kettle Restaurant in Weymouth next week on the 18th. And I'm not sure of the time because I didn't write it down. Bill, you know what time that is?
6 o'clock.
6 o'clock. So that's next week, South Shore Council, people that are interested in going. The next couple of meetings, next week we have our Million Dollar Meal at Southeastern Regional. They're going to host us. It's a great time. It's the Million Dollar Meal. There'll be some other guests from there, from the other clubs that are coming that Mr. Lindy invited as well. Mark, you have any quick words?
I hope you will get a chance to see over at Southeastern. Students built a tiny house this year that they displayed at the open house. So the superintendent is kind of his pride and joy, so he'll show you it, and you can go inside and take a look.
No, thank you so much, Mark. Appreciate that. So that's next week, the 19th. So we do not at Rotary. I mean, we're not at Thony Lee next week. We're at Southeastern Regional. Put that on your calendars, starting at the noontime, 12:15 range. So that's next week. The following week, the 26th, Doyle's didn't commit to us, so we're going to be at Thony Lee the 26th for lunch. So put that back in your calendars. It would be our return to Thony Lee for 2017. Also, Amy's been working hard. I know a couple of people maybe have got some too. Raffles for the pancake breakfast coming up on April 1st. That's April 1st. It's one of our best fundraisers. Amy's going to continue to grab raffles. Anybody else that can help grab raffles would be greatly appreciated through your own business or a business contact, a colleague. All is much appreciated. It's a great time to raise some money for the Rotary to give back to the community. Billy C. had a membership meeting last week. And Bill, I don't know if you wanted to... Thank you, Mr. Lutz. I don't know if you want to give a quick 2 seconds.
I will. Eric is clapping because we had some leftover Cape Cod pizza, and he got to take it home. So, let's see. It was Amy, Richard, Robert, Eric, Rolando, me, and Mark. And how can I forget Kenny Oliveri? Came all the way from South, where are you, Fall River, Rhode Island or something? We had a very nice meeting. We're putting together a kind of a membership survey to kind of get into what our club likes, doesn't like, what we need to do. So more to come very soon.
Good old Billy C. Thank you, Bill. We have some inductions to do today, too. Which is going to be nice to bring some new members into this club as we continue to grow. One other thing I just wanted to remind people, I talked about at the beginning of the program, and put this on your calendars, please. I think it's important that we have a good showing there and support our friend Jim Morris. On Friday, 1:20 is going to be a service for him, a memorial service at Bay Point in Brockton.
Tomorrow, Friday?
1:20.
January 20th.
January 20th at Bay Point, 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Put it on your calendars, please. It'll be a great opportunity to show support. Jim's done a tremendous amount for this club over the years, for the South Shore Council, for Rotary International in general, and I think it'd be behoove us to get there and show support from Rotary to Jim. And Elaine, you had... I'm going to have Betty put that on in an email to remind people as well, yes. But if you have your phones right now, a piece of paper, whatever it is, put it down, write it down, put it on your calendar so if you don't forget. Mr. Tennant.
Sure. I'm always happy, and my club knows that. Always happy to be here with you guys, and I'm especially happy that I get a Debbie Brooks too.
Thank you, Mr. Tennant. Any other happy dolls this afternoon? Mr. Cooney.
Yes, I want to congratulate Fred Fontaine for opening this place and adding to the economic vitality of the city. And the food is excellent, so thank you very much.
Thank you, Fred. Appreciate that today. Thank you, Mr. Cooney. Mr. Morgan's collecting. Anybody else happy this afternoon? Mr. Lutz.
Yep, happy to have a couple of guests from the Boys and Girls Club. Hope to get the Interact Club rolling there as soon as we can.
No, thank you, Eric. Appreciate that.
Santa hat?
Yeah, Santa hat today. It's the gift. Any other happy dolls this afternoon? Mr. Lindy.
Happy to be here with all of you and happy that my dad made his 90th birthday last Sunday.
Wow, that's excellent. Mr. Doc McCool.
Happy to say that my youngest son, Dan, proposed to his now fiance at the Rockefeller Center in front of the Christmas tree.
That's nice.
December 22nd. It's very, 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 very happy.
That's great. Thank you, Doc. Any last happy dollars? Mr. Lutz again.
Just one more. How could I forget our Rotary friends from our B2B group come all the way up from Fall River to join us today, Kevin and Norm. Always a pleasure having them.
No, welcome, Kevin and Norm. Thank you for driving up today. Appreciate that. If no one else has it, I have my last happy buck here. I'll give, Mr. Trout.
I got two happy bucks. First, I think Tom was going to say something in response to a good wife, but something about just letting her talk whenever she wanted and stuff like that. And then you cut him off, and he said, hey, just like my wife. So.
Perfect.
Game last week, so I DVR'd it, so I'm going to watch it. I'm really hopeful that the Giants can pull it out.
Fred.
Well, I got a happy dollar for you guys, so have you here. Thank you very much for being here.
No, thanks, Fred. Thanks for having us. Appreciate that. I'll end out the happy dollars. Today, I have two happy dollars. One is my wife completed her first week of work. And she hasn't killed anybody yet, which is great. And then my second happy dollar is today is my mother's 74th birthday. Looking forward to spend some time with her, and it should be good. Thank you. I got some cheers. All right. We don't have a Queen of Hearts today, so I think we're going to be on to the next portion in... Richard, I don't know if you'd like to come up and introduce our guest speaker. Sorry. That's right. Apologize. I skipped over a portion. I'd like Mr. Lutz to come up and to do our installations this afternoon for a couple of new members.
Thank you very much, Brian. What Brian neglected to tell you there, not only is his mother 74, but she survived raising not just Brian, but... Three other brothers. She deserves a little bit more than a happy buck. Fellow Rotarians and guests and visiting Rotarians, my privilege and pleasure today to welcome into membership into our club two new members, Elizabeth Ferreira and Mark Mendez, who are being sponsored into membership by Mark Ferreira and Dan Trout. Their proposals have been reviewed in accordance with the Constitution and the bylaws of this club and approved by our Board of Directors. I now ask Elizabeth and Mark to come up here with their sponsors. And Mark's not here today. He's actually on a Salvation Army obligation. So I'd ask Bill Callahan, our membership director, to come up. Elizabeth Ferreira and Mark Mendez, we now proceed to welcome you into membership into the Rotary Club of Brockton, and also to the Fellowship of Rotary throughout the world. To truly belong in Rotary, you must first understand that the founding idea of Rotary is service. I don't know if many people know that more than yourself, Elizabeth, but our principal motto, and that of over 3,300 clubs throughout the world in over 200 countries, is service above self. And the object of this club and of all Rotary clubs is to encourage and foster this idea as a basis of worthy enterprise. You're both to share in this effort. You've been approved for membership in this club because we believe you to be worthy representatives of your vocation, interested in the ideals of Rotary, and willing to do your share in translating these ideals into tangible realities. You've agreed to accept these obligations attached to your membership in this club and to obey the club's constitution and bylaws. Now I have the pleasure of asking your sponsors to pin on you the Rotary emblem, which we expect you to wear when, Elaine?
At all times.
at all times and with great pride. And I did you a little solid there by giving a shout out to Elaine, because if you see her out in public and you do not have your pin on, she will find you, and she will fine you. Elizabeth and Mark, I'm proud to be the first to welcome you into the Rotary Club of Brockton. I now ask my fellow Rotarians to stand. Please give a warm Rotary welcome to our newest Rotarians, Elizabeth Ferreira and Mark Ringley. Mark and Elizabeth, welcome to the club. It's great to bring in new members into this club as we continue to grow. And as you can see, folks, we have a great attendance period today, and we must have 50 or 60 people here today, and it's a great opportunity and see some new members come in as well. At this time, Richard, I'd like you to come on up to introduce our guest speaker.
Thank you, Brian. Good afternoon, fellow Rotarians and guests. It's my pleasure to introduce today's speaker, Brian Shackman. Brian Shackman is news anchor for NBC Boston, and he's here today to tell us a little bit about all of that and the going on. And on a side note, Brian, he's had other involvement in the community. Brian has last year joined Crescent Credit on its day of spin-a-thon, raising money for the Old Colony Y. And as most of us probably know, that fundraiser goes to just an incredible amounts of good things, families use at all different levels. So that was a great thing. Also, Brian's involved with the School on Wheels. He's emceed a couple of their big galas. The race that they had, for me, a walk, he was at that. So thanks from all of us for that, Brian. With that, let's give a real warm welcome for Brian Shackman.
People don't watch TV the way they used to, right? And we talk about this a lot. And, you know, young people don't often turn the TV on as they're putting their tie on in the morning or while they're making breakfast. I remember having to, you know, finish dinner before 6:30 so my dad could watch Peter Jennings. And, you know, that's the household that I grew up in, right? But that's not the way it works. They can. But what we've learned is people still want information. They want stories. They want to know what's going on. And those are still hard facts. It's just, how do they do it? So it seems counterintuitive to launch a TV station in an already saturated market in a business that's not growing, right? I mean, but somehow NBC has made the decision, and I will tell you, Comcast does not like to lose money, right? They're in the business of making money, and they've made the sort of calculation that they can make money at this, because why would they? I've only been there 2 years, and I would say that in terms of, like, 100% being like Mike Nikitas, has been there for 30 years, and like 1% being the guy who just started yesterday. Like, my seniority is already in the, you know, I'm 80% higher. I mean, we've basically tripled our staff in 18 months, and it's incredible what we've undertaken. And I think the logic, and what I'm going to do is I'm going to talk a little bit about it. But then I'd like to open it up to questions or any comments you guys want to have, whether it's about me personally or about what we do. And NBC owns, see, anyone familiar with the concept of an owned station? Anybody? So NBC owns Philadelphia, NBC, they own New York, they own Washington, and they've always wanted to be in Boston. They look at it as a kind of a crown jewel of the news market for some reason, even though in terms of media size, we've actually gone down. I think we went down to 8 maybe this past year, and it used to be 6 and 7. And so they've been waiting forever, and Ed Anson over at HDH either asked for too much money or didn't want to sell, and so they made this decision to go it on their own. And it's complicated, right? Because now it's not just, you know, regular television. You have Xfinity, you have Fios, you have Charter, you have Cox, and so it's all on different channels, and it's hard to just, like, right now, our biggest problem is that people need to find us. Mm-hmm. I mean, literally, people have trouble finding us. And if you're in some part of the world that has WJR and Providence, it's like this is supposed to be the same channel. So it's very confusing for people to figure this out. Sure, if you want to watch The Voice or NFL football or what have you, you have to find that NBC, and that will be us. But NBC figured if they could take the resources and have everything in one region, they think if they corner a region, the Northeast, right, Boston, New York, Philly, D.C., they can use the redundancies to make it cost-effective to make money. And so that's why they've decided to drop anchor in Boston. And a lot of people ask, because a lot of people love NECN, too, because it's different, or at least it had been different for a long, long time. And, I mean, the way it is now, I mean, it's crazy. Right now we are running three TV networks in the same square foot footprint that we ran just one a year ago. We have Telemundo, NBC Boston, and NECN in one little crappy building. And of course, we're going to eventually move into a big building because, you know, we own Comcast Sports New England too. So they just redid two entire studios. They tripled the staff and they redid the whole building. And they're, as we speak, closing in on a deal to get another building to move everybody in, so it's all under one roof. And that should happen in the next 2 years or so. And the challenge really is, you know, sometimes people don't know who they're working for, where are our priorities, who, and right now the priority is obviously NBC Boston because it's just this huge endeavor and we want to make sure it gets off smoothly. And, you know, every sort of new business, as you know, a new venture has its hiccups and so on. And it's been fascinating. So for me, I'm 45 years old. I had a chance to sort of see the New York thing and see the network thing, and I got to a certain point, and I didn't progress past it, so I sort of came back. And so my ambitions are different. Like, I love what I do. I love to be here with these kind of events, and I like to write and to talk and to be in the news. I don't want to go back to network TV, and I don't have ambition. So it's interesting for me to mentor people. It's funny, when I was in New York at 42, you're sort of on the younger side, and things are moving this way. And now I come back to Boston, and I find myself more in a mentoring role because I literally have, you know, assistant producers who are half my age, and I've enjoyed it in the sense that, you know, journalism isn't a great leadership opportunity in many ways. I don't manage a lot of people, and I've always thought I had a natural inclination for leadership, but I'm always focused on, not myself from a selfish standpoint, but I got my story, my network, and my job, and I do it. You're very myopic in that sense. And so to come back and to try to help NBC Boston and all these new people sort of figure it out has been fun for me. It's been actually invigorating for me in a way that I had not imagined, because I don't need to get the network bigwigs to notice me, because I know most of them anyway, and I'm on the other side of that mountain. And so so it's nice to help people who want to get to that point, or you know, really learn their craft and hone their careers, and I've enjoyed that. Who knows what's going to happen? You know, it's difficult to say. I mean, I think the NBC brand is great. I think we have a lot of great programming, and we have to have a great product. But if we don't find ways to get people to consume things on Facebook and Twitter and Snapchat, those are the challenges, right? Because they still sell off of people who are 25 years old to 49 or whatever you consider that key demographic. So right now I do 7 to 10 in the morning on NECN, and I do the noon with LaToya, and we launched on January 1st. And it's been interesting. I mean, it's funny, and I'm interested. I don't know what your viewing habits are, but I'm interested to find out. I mean, if you've seen it, what you think of it, if you had trouble finding it. I mean, down in Brockton, I don't know what the major provider is, but
Comcast.
There you go. So that's, thank you very much. I appreciate that helping help pay for my health care. Yeah, go ahead.
It was a little difficult to find over the air. I got to go out a couple of years ago, and get it upstairs on 65.2 or 67, whatever the number is, on the UHF, and can't get it downstairs, which is where the main TV is.
Right.
So it's as you just said, I end up watching Channel 10 out of Rhode Island.
Right.
To get.
How many people watch over the air? Yeah. See, that's the, you know, it's funny because we have these conversations. Like, eventually, will the FCC change the way they do things, right? Will over the air not have to be the bar anymore? Since, I mean, if you put up those hands, I'd say that's less than 10% of the people here. And right now, they have to, that audience, although small and minority, has to be satisfied, or you can't do what we do. But we had to buy two different signals. I mean, I think the hope is to finally find a place where it's strong enough to cover everybody. And right now, that's not totally the case, although they're trying to figure out. And I think that they basically didn't want to kowtow to what HDH wanted, so they're like, we're going to figure out, we're going to do this any way we can, and then we'll make it better as we go. The one thing you do know is that there's only one chance to make a first impression, though, and so that would be troublesome if you never came back, right? And
it's it's a tricky thing where it's so far off with other channels, so when you're going through it, you get your 247.
Right.
And it's tough to go around the dial and go, okay, I'm gonna shoot out to...
Yeah. People do what's easiest, right? I mean, you know, if it's not easy, it's hard to do. We've had a lot of comments just like that, and I don't know the technical side of it, but I know that that is part of the challenge. And for me, you know, as someone who looks at these things, you know, from 30,000 feet, what I anchored in Hartford for 4 years, and then I left. And part of the reason I left was that the content wore on my soul, right? I mean, it truly did. Like, the difficulty of murders and drugs, and it just, you know, I wanted to do something more intellectual where nobody got hurt. And coming back to it, what I've realized is that it's not just that, it's the way people tell the stories. Like, I feel like the audiences are sophisticated, they're smart. You don't tease something and it's not that interesting. You know, you don't tell something, have a build up to something, you know, like Jimmy Hoffa's, you know, tomb. I mean, what I want to see more of is us reimagining the local product. And I think right now we have to focus on being clean and being solid, not, you know, having a picture of Trump coming up when I'm talking about something that's going on in Southie. Like, we want to make sure we're clean in what we do. And then, you know, Richard, I know you have want to ask me about something with what we do. And I think in terms of the regular story coverage, we're still going after sort of what everyone else goes after, but we're trying around the edges, do things that are different, and ultimately deliver value to people that makes it worth watching. Now, you can be the judge of that, you know, as it goes. But so far, we've done some things that I think have been really, really dynamic. Do you want to ask that question?
Yeah. So the investigative part that I see on NBC. Tell us about that. What if we have problems with consumers or whatever we can call there? Is that what that's basically?
Yeah. So there's two things. There's that. I forget the way they named that. And then there's the actual. There's a consumer investigative and there's a straight investigative. We have a form and a phone number. If you're having any trouble, say your power provider, there's a fee on your cell phone bill that doesn't make any sense to you and no one's given you a good answer, anything at all. I guess nationwide, and I just learned this today, this group and all the owned stations saved people about $5 million.
Yeah.
And so what we're saying to you is that no matter what, if you call us or email us, we will respond and we will make an effort to figure it out. And that is actionable. Like, it's not just like this, you know, this, we're on, five is on your side, and, you know, like all those sort of cliches from the classic local news. We're actually, and our team, and we have the investigator, Allie Donnelly and Leslie Gatiss, who've been in this market for a long, long time. Leslie Gatiss, who's married to Jack Harper, who just retired from Channel 5. I mean, she is gold standard in New England. I mean, she's such a great reporter. And the other side of it is, you know, investigative, that's like not just like, you know, where are the bed bugs at the Motel 6 and blah, blah, blah. Like, we're trying to actually, like, we did a thing on concussion safety that was a really huge story. And we did a thing on wrong way driving, which who would have thought that it's this incredible problem where people die in Massachusetts every year.
Two people I know recently.
Yeah, I mean, it's incredible. And then in Rhode Island, they came up with a solution and they've almost gone to zero. And so, like, why isn't Massachusetts doing exactly what Rhode Island does? And things like that. And then you get to the governor. So one thing we're doing that people haven't done in years is that we do the story, then we go to the State House and we ask them, this is what we found, what are you going to do about it? And if you do that in a cocktail hour across the street from the State House, you'll get one answer. But if you put the camera and a microphone in front of them, they got to say something productive. Because if they don't, it's on the record. And so the hope is, and not that, I have trust in a lot of our state politicians, believe it or not, and I think that they want to do good. Because you wouldn't take jobs at this level, in my opinion, if you didn't want to do good, because it doesn't pay. But to put them on the record and make them accountable, and we just asked, and probably wouldn't have asked if we asked Governor Baker something about maybe school bus drivers and their records, and he was mad at the reporter. But the reporter wanted to follow through, and he went on the record, and he said he was going to look into it, and he has to look into it because he said it on the record. And he knows the substance of what that means. And you put it in the backdrop of some of the national politics, and reporters need to be able to ask hard questions. I mean, forget about what Trump did yesterday. News conferences with the president have become more and more controlled and less direct over the last decade. So it's not a partisan thing or what have you. Is that, you know, this institution of journalism's got a bad rap, and a lot of it is deserved. But, you know, one thing we're trying to do is to be able to ask questions, the real questions, and get real responses. So to answer, we're actually trying to do something that's actionable for people instead of have something that we can tease at 11 that's going to get you to watch and ultimately be disappointed. Like, I think we're too sophisticated now. We don't have enough time. We don't waste time on garbage. And so why insult people with stuff that won't actually help? And who knows if we can pull it off, but I think, you know, that's something we're committed to. I really wanted to build in some time for questions, whether it's about the business. And I'm pretty, if you haven't noticed, I'm pretty transparent. I'm happy to answer anything about what goes on the backside of things or me personally.
Do you see the local news being more on the good side of things rather than showing a shooting in Dorchester or something that's going on that's always blood and guts? Then saying Meals on Wheels is doing this, and within this community, Brockton's doing this. Do you ever see like more emphasis on that than rather than seeing the shootings? I mean, we don't want to see that.
Yeah, you know, it's funny because, you know, my wife has a degree in social work, and she's a school counselor, and she's like, and even Leslie Gettys, we talk about, like, you know, we would off camera say, well, that wouldn't be in our good news show. Like, I still think that there's this sort of lemming mentality that if there is something bad that happens, everyone else is going to do it, so we have to do it too. And no one's necessarily had the courage to break from that. But they all say that the studies show that what you say and what I feel isn't what the consensus is in the community. But I have so many more people say that to me than the shooting in Dorchester. And the only thing I can come away with, and I don't know how this is going to sound, but sometimes I feel like there's an audience that watches local news maybe to feel better about their own life, to see somebody else in misery. I don't know, because some of the stuff just truly weighs on your soul. Having said that, I'd like to see the template broken a little bit. It's going to take some courage, and it's going to have to translate in the numbers, because the people at the top, even though Nielsen numbers are flawed in how they calculate them, they're still very important to these executives. You can say whatever you'd like.
Well, I have an 11 and a 13-year-old, and when the news comes on, I tell them to change the channel because I don't want them to watch it.
My wife doesn't let my kids watch.
So I think you're missing out on a big segment of it because of that.
Yep.
Because if it was good news and good things that are happening, I'd tell them to leave it on NCN all day. You know, so I don't know. I don't think I'm the minority on that.
No, I appreciate it. I'm more on your side than I'm not. And especially since, you know, I always used to talk to my wife I don't want to be a news director. Those are the person who runs the news department, because A, those people seem to get fired every 2 years, and B, I just think that I would do it in a way that probably would get me fired. And I feel like every reporter should have time every week or every month to go do a story they want to do, something that we call evergreen, something that'll live for that slow day. So, you know, I look at fires. You know, LaToya's mom just had a fire in Dorchester, and so I don't want to make light of it, because it can destroy lives. And if I had my house on fire and I lost everything I had, I'd be in tears and I'd be destroyed. Being a little bit objective on it, though, unless there's something, it's a thing where you put a camera on something and it's easy and it's free, but it only maybe impacts that one place. And I like to talk more about things that impact everybody. And those stories, I'd like to tell more of as well. And listen, I don't have a direct answer for you. I try to make sure we get in our newscasts things that are fun. But I can't, I mean, I went on the air for over an hour yesterday about a school bus crash, because it was a school bus crash on a highway. The kids are all okay, but it's a school bus crash, and they think that, you know, everyone, you know, and I'm in my head, I'm being like, okay, is this something that merits this kind of attention? I don't know. I mean, I think everyone who's got kids has kids that go on the bus, so maybe there's, you know, stoking fears, I'm not sure. So
I think stoke fears, like it gets everybody
Up. I think it's going to take courage, and I think it's going to, at some point, have to translate into people liking that. I think that an executive, a news director, which I am not, would come back to you and say, people don't want that. And then you're telling me that you do. So I'm not in a position to affect that in the macro. I try to do it as much as I can and encourage, because we talk about what we should cover before we go on air. You know, I don't get in there 20 minutes before air and just, you know, put my makeup on. And I try to push for things that have more of a general appeal. Sometimes it's still bad, but at least it appeals to more people. It's not just the best video. I mean, the one thing I can't stand is, why are we doing that? Because we have good video. I mean, that's a tough way to justify it, but that's what I get back at me, you know, because people are in this mode. You know, people say sports, nobody cares about sports. And sports is interesting because people are cutting sports all across the country. And I think, okay, that's great, because they can get, everything's on your phone. I do everything sports related. I don't watch TV. I don't watch TV. I watch TV for a sporting event, or, you know, my wife is getting me, she had me watch This Is Us right now. So I'm watching that. But I didn't see the episode this week, so don't tell me. I don't want to hear it. I don't want to hear it. So, but sports, I started my career in a newspaper, and I truly feel that, like, okay, so people don't need to see Celtics highlights on NBC Boston, but let's go out and the hundreds of thousands of great high school stories that are out there. And if you know what, I believe you build an audience one person at a time. If I did something on your son or your granddaughter or somebody, and then you all watched it, then everyone in that school system's like, did you see that? NBC Boston, this awesome story on Joey Jr., the chess champ, or Johnny, the QB. And here we are doing 99% professional sports. And I feel like, and again, like, I'm in no place to really come out. Because if I raise my hand and I say something, it's not going to affect change. I tell people whenever I can. But those are the little things. So I think, like, kids are where the stories are. Kids, you know, like, that's where we can get great stories, both you know, uplifting and inspiring, and also maybe helping people. I mean, you know how many solicitations we get for GoFundMe pages because of really difficult stories that people need help on all the time. And so I agree with that. Now you're making me think, like, maybe I need to go back and get off it a little bit and speak up a little more on that stuff, especially related to sports. Yes?
Do you see NBC Boston working with any of the local media outlets? I run the local cable channel here in Brockton, but that's our camera. And I'm just wondering, when you're talking about high school sports, that's what we do. But the only time it ever gets on is Thanksgiving Day.
Right.
It happens all year long. There's a whole regular season.
Yep.
There's multiple teams. Brockton, for whatever reason, ends up on Boston News when something's bad. And
right.
Brockton's a pretty good place. And it sounds like you want to bring the good news to the public.
I think the most important thing for now, because these things take time and baby steps, would be to communicate. I mean, if there's something going on that we don't know about, I mean, like I said to Richard, we look at the enterprise all the time. You know, I mean, we're always plugged into the community. Let us know. I mean, I've thrown a lot of stories at sports. Right now, it's like a one-man sports department, so they don't have the staff yet, so they can't do a lot of stuff. But I'd say, you know, I can give you my email address or whatever. Let's just start to talk, and then. You know, I can pass it up the food chain and try to be accountable in that sense. I mean, in Connecticut, and I'll get to you in one second. Connecticut, you know, Hartford's kind of not much going on, and New Haven, what is similar. We covered the whole state, so like high school sports were huge. And Friday night, because I started off as a sports anchor, was Friday night football, and it was all high school, and we would shoot, you know, as many games as we could, and try to get like a dozen to 15 sets of highlights. And that's what we did. And just Boston doesn't seem to do that as much as it should. And I believe, like, I truly believe, like, every roster, every person has a story. You know, Boston College has 85 guys on their football roster. Every kid has got a story. So I feel like there's no shortage of stories. So let's talk. I'll give you my stuff. I think you had a question right there?
I was just going to say I call it the NBC News bad news ticker on my phone. I don't know how I got it, but it'll tell me what's going on. Is there one for the local station?
A ticker?
Well, almost like when I pick my phone up, it says right now something like the DOJ is investigating Clinton emails, what just came across.
Yeah, so that's like a push notification.
Yes.
So I think you can sign up for that. I think if you get the app, the NBC app, and there still is an NBC app. Like, I don't, go ahead.
Well, that is the NBC app, but it's,
I'm sorry,
app, but it's, you know, national.
Right, so there's an NBC Boston app.
Oh.
And you can have the option for a push notification with that, and they do that, and you can get the same type of thing. And I think NACN does it too. I'm fascinated to see moving forward, like how we're all going to live together, right? I mean, you know, because I think people who like NACN love NACN, right? And there's people who want New England news and not just Boston news or what have you. So I still don't know what it's going to look like. They've told us that NACN is going to remain a priority. It's just going to be interesting to see, because we get lots of great stories from Connecticut, Maine, and New Hampshire, and Vermont. So if you have download the app, and if it doesn't give you that option, let me know, because I think you could. They push stuff out all the time on big news. Yes.
Just as a casual observer, I've lived in a few different places, and my wife is from New York. We've always kind of commented how New York City, which I think is still the biggest media market in the country, the newscaster, the local broadcast, is remarkably B-grade.
Yep.
How is it, why is it that New York puts what I think is a terrible product out there,
yep,
and it's the biggest one in America? In Boston, I've lived in a lot of different places, and Boston seems to be the cream of the crop as far as broadcast.
I'm giving my opinion. I think that nobody watches it in New York. And I mean, the only reason they're big jobs is because it's expensive to live in New York and all the executives watch it. So if you want to get noticed and make it big, it's good to be on in New York. I truly, like, none of my friends who live in New York watch local news. I mean, they're watching Morning Joe, or they're watching Fox News, or what have you. They're not watching WNBC. Or maybe they're catching it for the last 2 minutes before the Today Show. And that's why, like, WNBC, they've reacted to that. They do this nice whip around right before 7, where they go to all their live reporters and they just do 30 seconds to give you the news and then get out. That's probably the best part of what they do, and they're on from 5 a.m. to 7. So I know a lot of people who are on in New York locally, and they're all really actually talented people, but I think that the product isn't great because I think that it's just not consumed a lot, and I think Boston's just more competitive. I truly do. My news director was the news director at WABC for 10 years, and he always has all these stories comparing New York and Boston. But the thing that's interesting is that Boston just, you have to be from here to make it, in my opinion, and we don't suffer fools. I mean, New York will hire somebody from L.A. or Seattle. They'll come right in, and they'll do fine. In Boston, I mean, you mispronounce Gloucester, you're in trouble. You know? So I think that it's you have to be sharp to be here, because people don't suffer fools. I mean, we're not notoriously grumpy for no reason, you know? I mean, we are that way. Yes, go ahead.
First of all, I want to thank you for your service to our little section of the community here. Richard had mentioned your involvement with CCU. I was at the School on Wheels Gala there, and they talked about bringing children down there to pack backpacks. Everybody here, just, you know, reaching out. This is somebody that walks the walk, doesn't just talk the talk. So thanks for that. Second, I'm really curious these days. There's a lot of talk about fake news.
Yes.
And then you kind of definitely glossed over what happened at yesterday's press conference there. And how do you see this stuff sort of sifting out? I'm just asking for your crystal ball version of it here in the future.
I don't know. I think that I've really grown, you know, I don't want to get into politics because I don't want to, I tried really hard through this election cycle to keep my personal feelings out of my work. And so even though this is an informal environment, it's tough because you don't know how people feel. And I think the one thing our institution did is that we did not respect the Trump supporters and the Trump candidacy. And I think that the one thing about New England that's interesting, because Trump spent time in Massachusetts, and he's always going to get thumped in Massachusetts. You're like, why did he do that? And what you realize is that, and Obama used this, and we talked about this. I'm gonna get to an answer to you. Obama went into areas that he was gonna get thumped too, because instead of losing 70 to 30, he'd lose 60 to 40, and it would really create a little bit of a base for himself. But I always cautioned for our shows, because it got in our writing. Disrespectful adjectives got into our introductions to pieces on Trump. And I said, you know what, I fought against it all the time. And I have a really pro-Trump neighbor who took it too far. I mean, I'll be honest, I'm a Jewish member of the media. And, you know, and those two things for Trump supporters are pretty negative. And I got I have problems in my neighborhood. Because not because of what I did or because of what I represented. So I believe that it's going to be, we're not all a little nervous, but I think we really don't know. And I think that the issue of fake news, once the cat's out of the bag, I mean, if you really counted the things that were categorically not true that, say, Trump tweeted, and it didn't affect him. I always go back to Governor Rick Perry. Governor Rick Perry forgot one agency in the federal government. His entire campaign got destroyed, right? That's like a Tuesday for Trump, right? So, and it didn't affect him. But you have to respect the power of what he's done, and you have to. I don't think it's so much a pro-Trump issue as it is it's an anti-government issue for people, and people don't trust government, and they don't trust the media for whatever reason. And so, Trump represents going against both of those things. And so I think that in some ways for government, Trump is refreshing because he's making people, because Washington, D.C. is the biggest business in the world, and it doesn't run that efficiently, right? Mm-hmm. And so deep down, I think it's great to get some people called on the carpet and be accountable for it. Is he the right person for it? I'm not going to speak to that. Now, to the media, I think a lot of that's true, too, because anyone can publish anything. Mm-hmm. It's difficult to know what's true and not true. And what was dangerous about yesterday is that CNN actually did not publish what BuzzFeed published. If you read in on the story, they didn't necessarily give credence to this thing that really does not look credible, right, this document. It just said that the intelligence community said that they think Russia had stuff on Trump. That's what they said. They didn't give credence to the document. So to put, like Kellyanne Conway did, and I don't want to get too inside baseball, but Kellyanne Conway grouped the two together. And what I thought was and they shouldn't be together, right? What BuzzFeed did is much different than what CNN did. What I'm very fascinated by is CNN, when I was a child, when there was an earthquake, you put on CNN. When somebody got shot, you put on CNN. Like, CNN for me was the default news source. So for them to be labeled as fake news, whether it's true or not, because that was troubling in the sense that what was for me a beacon of truth, or at least just gave me the story. So whether if they're biased, that's a problem. If they're being mislabeled as fake news, that's a problem. So I'm concerned, but the Washington Post and the New York Times are two of the most respected brands in all of journalism, and they really hurt themselves. The New York Times, the Huffington Post refused to cover Trump. The New York Times was so obviously biased against him that it really hurt them. You know, and they still do great journalism. You know, they do so many other things, but I think it really did hurt the brand. So some of these news sources that I revere, like, for instance, I always, in emails, for the most part, although since I've come back to Boston, I stopped doing it, I go Brian A. Shackman. My first byline for the Worcester Telegram and Gazette was Brian A. Shackman. And my joke was always that when I got the job with the New York Times, I'd fit in because I used my middle initial. And so, anyway, if you don't like that joke. But, the New York Times is like this incredible institution, and they really hurt themselves. So I think it's going to be very interesting to watch. He's going to break down a lot of traditions, and some of it will feel dirty, and others might feel refreshing. I don't really know. Every time I've sold him short on something, he's really surprised me. And so I know that he's president. That's one thing I know. And if you want access to him in an unfettered way, you're probably not going to get it unless you're flattering toward him. And what Jim Acosta did for CNN and what Hallie Jackson did for NBC when she asked about the taxes, I have a lot of respect for them. And because he is at the front of the podium and he can drown anybody out. So you really have to fight for the question to get heard. and he's going to maybe end up making you look bad. But I think that the real journalism is not happening in a lot of spheres, but I think it's more important than ever to have real journalists left. I don't even consider myself as much a journalist anymore because I'm not in the streets as much as I used to or should be. But the people that are on the ground, the people who are real journalists looking for actual truth and not just what they want to find, are more important than ever. And they have to fight to get those questions.